Max Bankman. I'm the new doctor.
Welcome aboard the Odyssey.
ABC Thursdays.
This ship is heaven. We're tending to our passengers' dreams. I'm in.
From 911 executive producer Ryan Murphy comes a splashy new drama on a luxury cruise ship with Joshua Jackson and Don Johnson.
It's your job to keep everyone alive.
She's in VFib. One, two, three. Clear.
I have a pulse.
You're going to be okay.
Dr. Odyssey. Thursdays, 9, 8 Central on ABC. And stream on Hulu.
The political ride of Michelle Fiore, with her over-the-top personality and knack for finding controversy, seems to be over. A fixture in local and even national headlines since her first election win in 2012, Fiore was convicted by a federal jury last week of wire fraud. Today on CityCast Las Vegas, we talk with Review Journal reporter Caitlin Newberg about Fiore's speedy trial and guilty verdict. And as she vows to fight on, will Fiore successfully brand herself a martyr, or will a likely prison stint douse the firebrand the media has dubbed Lady Trump? It's Tuesday, October 8th. I'm David Figler, and here's what Las Vegas is talking about. Caitlin, these criminal charges seem pretty basic. Fiore was collecting money for a fallen officer's memorial through her nonprofit and then diverted funds she received to personal use with zero spent on the memorial. Is there more to this federal wire fraud charge than that?
Well, a lot of the federal wire fraud charge comes from how the feds wanted to approach this case. They were talking about how these bank transfers go across state lines when she's taking the money from one account and putting them to a different account. So that's kind of why we ended up in federal court, it seems like. Because even during the trial, they were talking a lot about state law instead of federal law. They were talking about state campaign laws and issues and all of that. But it is pretty much that simple. They accused her of raising a bunch of money through her PAC and her charity organization, and then not using it for the intended purpose.
But according to the prosecution, Caitlin, all this seemingly started as far back as the summer of 2019, yet she wasn't indicted until just this last July, July 2024. Why did it take so long?
Yeah, the alleged donations and all of this fraud started in 2019, but her house wasn't raided by the FBI until 2021.
Okay.
That was part of an investigation the FBI was doing into her that was very broad. And from my understanding, they were just looking for evidence of some sort of misconduct. But as part of this raid, they found financial records and they started building a case on these wire fraud charges as they relate to the statue. And then they decided to indict her this year, and they managed to get Governor Joe Lombardo on the stand, even though he donated her way back a couple years ago.
Yeah, I'm curious about who testified. But before we get to any of that, the way you're describing it, it sounds a little bit like it was a government fishing expedition and they just kind of happened to land this idea around defrauding people based on this memorial for these fallen officers or this fallen officer in our community. Was that part of the defense, that the government was targeting her, or what was her defense?
I mean, that was definitely her main defense, that the government had it out for her, that they went into their house with one goal in mind, and that was to find some sort of crime she was accused of. And yeah, her defense attorney basically made that argument to the jury that the FBI had it out for her.
Well, before we get into those actual twists and turns of the trial, I think it's fair to say that a lot of locals have, for better or worse, a fascination with Fiore and her antics over the years. What do you think has made her such a polarizing character in our community?
Well, she definitely has a big personality. She is relatively combative with reporters sometimes. She doesn't really like to play by the rules that other politicians will play by in interviews and whatnot. You have that infamous calendar of her from a couple years ago of her and a whole family holding AK-47s.
Including the little kitties.
Including the kids. Yeah. You have her connection to the Bundys. Like, she is just a very big figure in Las Vegas with a lot of lore that I think people are very interested in.
Yeah, I remember when the Politico article came out, and the title of that piece was "The Lady is a Trump." And that's where this whole like Lady Trump moniker came. And she leaned into it, I think. But even more than that, I mean, there have been comments that she's made in her various elected capacities. She was an assemblywoman. She was a city council person. She is now a non-lawyer judge in Pahrump, although that seems like it's going to come to a quick end. But she has gotten in fistfights with fellow city council people. And I mean, some of the comments are really over the top. So I just wonder if like there's more attention on this just because of who she is.
Yeah, I mean, I think she, for lack of a better phrase, I think she has a lot of enemies in town too. There were a couple of women who were watching this whole trial who don't like Fiore. And after the trial, one of them like put on a shirt that said Michelle Fiore is a criminal now.
Wow. Was it a pink shirt? Because Fiore tends to love pink when she's at a high and wears a lot of black when she's at a low.
Well, it was actually a black t-shirt. So.
There you go.
But yeah, there's a lot of people who like her, but there's also a lot of people who have very strong feelings and dislike her.
It's strange. She does have a lot of charisma. And unlike a lot of people who are sort of categorized in the right wing, you know, she's been a champion for LGBT rights and things of that nature. She presents herself at least as being a very complex person. But yeah, you're not wrong. People definitely have drawn their opinions. So, well, let's get back into talk about the trial. There were some pretty well-known people who testified as victims. Tell me about that.
Yeah, so the biggest witness we had was Governor Joe Lombardo. A lot of attorneys were saying, you know, I've never heard of a time when a sitting governor was testifying in a criminal trial. So that was obviously our biggest. You had the owner of a bunch of strip clubs in town. Yeah, he testified. You had the developer of the Aria, so big land developer. You had the CEO of Community Ambulance, the former mayor of Henderson, just a lot of business owners were up there, a lot of like high profile people.
The controversial head of the building trades, Tommy White, he was also listed, I think.
Yeah.
And prominent defense attorney, David Chesnoff.
Oh, yeah. He got up on the stand, too.
Wow. So I wasn't following it as closely as you were. All these folks, just a parade of high-profile individuals who all gave money to Fiore. What was the time frame? Was she still a city councilwoman when she was soliciting these funds?
Yes, she was still on the city council when this was all happening. And a lot of it was these people saying like, oh, I authorized so-and-so with my charity to send this check over. Mm-hmm. It seemed like a lot of the witnesses didn't personally write a check to Michelle and like deeply paid attention to what was happening.
So did they come across as being just sort of asleep at the wheel, or were they enamored with Fiore and whatever pitch she made to them? How did it shake down?
I don't think it was asleep at the wheel. It was more like she was raising money for a fallen officer. A lot of people said when they got on the stand, you know, we donate to a lot of law enforcement organizations. So you have this guy who was tragically killed in 2014 with his partner. That was a big story at the time. So yeah. I think they just wanted to give money to that. It didn't seem like these people were the type who were going to watch where everything went if you're giving money to all of these various organizations.
Yeah. I mean, to the tune of $70,000 in total donations.
This episode is sponsored by BetterHelp. Sometimes when I'm not feeling well emotionally, I feel like I'm hiding behind a mask. If I'm taking my showbiz persona into my personal life and pretending everything is okay when it's really not, I know it's time to check in with a therapist. Because masks are for Halloween, not for my emotions. We all go through tough times, and in the past, I have found it really helpful to get an outside opinion to navigate my own emotions. And in my personal experience, every time I've begun therapy, I've also eventually come to a place where I realize I was doing okay, and it was time to stop. Therapy doesn't have to be a lifelong commitment, but that resource is always there if and when you need it. And with BetterHelp, it's designed to be convenient, flexible, and suited to your schedule, and it's entirely online. So take off the mask with BetterHelp. Visit betterhelp.com/citycast today and get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/citycast.
Hi, this is David Plotz of CityCast. Have you thought about a gift for yourself this year? One that has the power to help you grow and learn and become a better version of yourself? Give yourself the gift of language by getting Babbel. With quick 10-minute lessons handcrafted by language experts, Babbel gets you talking a new language in 3 weeks. Because talking is the key to really knowing a language. And that's how Babbel approaches it. It's designed for real conversation. So I have a trip to France planned with my girlfriend. Was it inspired by the Olympics? Yes, it was. And it's given me the chance to revive my old high school French. And it's so fun to catch back up with the vocabulary I'd forgotten, to remember all the food, for example. I'm in a lesson on ingredients, so I'm going to make crepes with butter and sugar. Avec sucre et de beurre salé, on va se régaler. We're going to have a feast. I learned this great new French expression too. J'en ai l'eau à la bouche. That means I have water in the mouth. That means it's mouth-watering. Love it. Love French. Anyway, Babbel gets you talking, and studies from Yale and Michigan State University and other leading universities prove that it works. So here is a special holiday deal for CityCast listeners. Right now, get up to 60% off your Babbel subscription, but only for CityCast listeners at babbel.com/citycast. Get up to 60% off at babbel.com/citycast, spelled BABBEL.com/citycast. Rules and restrictions may apply.
You know, of all the people that you listed, the only one that I really saw reporting on was Governor Lombardo. And there seemed to be some contention. The defense attorney, in this case, Mike Sanf, seemed to scoff at the fact that Lombardo was calling himself a victim. Can you explain why it was up in the air if Lombardo was actually a victim or not?
Yeah, so Lombardo's donation came from his campaign fund for when he was sheriff. So his sheriff campaign donated $5,000 to Fiore. Mm-hmm. Sanft was trying to make the argument that Lombardo did the very thing that Fiore was accused of doing, whereas he took money that was meant for a specific purpose and he donated it to get him elected. Right. And then he donated that to a statue, which is obviously not to get him elected.
Right.
Whereas Fiore was accused of taking all of this money that was meant for a statue and then using it on other expenses. Sanf didn't go so far as like admit that she was spending it on personal stuff, but
Just said if it's good for the sheriff goose, it's good for the defendant gander.
Yeah, it was like the governor is basically doing the same thing. Your guys aren't going to charge him. Why are you charging Michelle? So that was kind of why he was scoffing at Lombardo thinking of himself as a victim. And then Lombardo got pretty upset on the stand that he was being asked these questions too. It was very like insistent, like, I'm a victim here.
Very interesting. So what were the things that she was alleged on spending the money that was supposed to go for this statue?
The prosecutors focused on three main expenses here. One was her rent for a rental property. The other was payments on one of her daughter's weddings. And then the third was plastic surgery. And we didn't get a whole lot of details on that, just that
they just threw that out there.
They just kind of threw it out there. Yeah. They didn't tell us what plastic surgery she was accused of getting, just that she spent money at a plastic surgery office in town that she frequented.
Did they provide receipts and things of that nature?
They had somebody from the office testify.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah. You mentioned her daughter's wedding. The defense called one of Fiore's daughters, Sheena Siegel, to help her mother. Was that the daughter who got married, or is that a different daughter?
Different daughter. So Sheena Siegel was accused of being Fiore's co-conspirator, even though Siegel was not charged with anything. Savannah Kame was the daughter who got married.
Okay. So when the defense called Fiore's daughter Sheena to help her mother, that didn't seem to go as anticipated. What happened there?
Yeah. So Sanft was saying that Sheena was on the government's list of witnesses. And then the government didn't call her. Mm-hmm. So Sanf was saying, now that the government hasn't called her, we still want her on the stand to testify to some things that are important to our case. it sounds like they wanted her to talk about how she took a lot of money from her mom, and she was saying she spent it on charity costs, like supplies for various fundraisers and events that Michelle was throwing. But during her testimony, as the prosecutors were questioning her, they ended up talking about checks that Sheena had from her mom's accounts.
Okay, so it sounds like she implicated herself, but then there was something about immunity. All the confusion, how did it wind down?
She basically got on the stand, and the prosecutors tried to accuse her of admitting to a federal crime on the stand, and that she might have signed a check that came from her mother's account, which she shouldn't have. We paused the whole trial. The judge had to call in a public defender to talk to her, to talk to her about her rights. Sheena gets back on the stand, and she starts pleading the fifth to everything. She says, I'm not going to incriminate myself. The prosecutors kept asking her questions, and eventually were like, are you going to plead the fifth to everything we're asking you? And she said, yes. So they got her testimony stricken.
What was this about immunity? Did she think she had immunity to be able to testify about anything?
Well, the immunity aspect of this was interesting because even the judge implied that she didn't know about it. But the prosecutors were basically saying that we granted her immunity if she was honest with us about her mother's campaign fund allegations, right? Mm-hmm. And then the implication seemed to be that once Sheena got on the stand and may have admitted to misappropriating checks, that that was not covered by the immunity agreement.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
And so it wound up just getting struck altogether. They told the jury, ignore the last day of craziness that you just saw.
Yeah.
Is that basically what happened?
Basically, yeah. And Sanft, Michelle's defense was saying that it was the government's fault that the testimony got stricken. But at the end of the day, the judge just said, we have to ignore all of this.
And then what happened was the jury was out for, I don't know, the length of time it takes to finish a sandwich. And they came back with guilty on all counts. Were you surprised by the verdict?
I don't know if I was surprised by the verdict because of the length of time it took the jury to deliberate. Usually when a jury is deliberating for a short amount of time, it's going to be a guilty verdict. That's just the general common sense when you're covering trials. Mm-hmm. It seems, I mean, Sam said it too after the trial, that it seemed like they made up their mind halfway through testimony and all they had to do was go back there, eat a sandwich for lunch, and then check guilty on the verdict form.
Well, what do you think this whole trial, Caitlin, says about the Nevada political landscape, that a scam like this could even happen here?
I mean, a lot of people, I think, still view Nevada kind of as the Wild West, right? It's pretty common knowledge that Nevada is a crazy news state. We have a lot of very interesting politicians.
And politicians and personalities, yeah, for sure.
Politicians and personalities, yeah. And I think this is just another example of somebody maybe taking advantage of that system, whereas we don't have a whole lot of national attention on us. And stuff like this can seemingly fall through the cracks. And then you get crazy stories about Michelle Fiore being accused of spending campaign donations on plastic surgery.
Right. Well, I mean, it's not like we don't hear all sorts of wild allegations, most of which bear out to be true, when you have a lot of elected officials who have side hustles, whether it's philanthropic or entrepreneurial. And then you have other prominent people in the community who sometimes are other politicians or people currying favor who give money to them. And then, it all seems to go up in smoke. I mean, is this a Michelle Fiore problem or a Nevada problem?
I mean, everyone seems to talk about Las Vegas as being a big city with a small town vibe. And I think that kind of applies to all of Nevada as well, whereas there's not a lot of people making these big decisions. It's kind of a small group. And sometimes I think when you have an insulated group, corruption is bound to happen.
Or people being a little sloppy on all sides of the equation. Yeah.
Yeah.
So Caitlin, she was convicted of 6 counts. Many of those counts carry up to 20 years in prison. I don't know that there's anyone who thinks that she's going to get 100 years in prison, but she is an elected official who did this while she was an elected official. It involves, a scam, if you will, that took advantage of dead police officers involving very high profile people in the community. Do you think that there's any chance she won't get at least some prison time out of this?
I think the judge is pretty likely to sentence her to some prison time. This judge seems to be very no nonsense, and she took the case very seriously.
This is federal judge Jennifer Dorsey, and she does have that reputation. Yeah.
Yeah, she was very efficient and no nonsense throughout the whole trial. But yeah, Fiore doesn't have an extensive criminal record. I don't really think it's common for federal defendants to be sentenced to over 100 something years. Yeah. There's always, and you can set sentences to run concurrently with each other.
Sure.
So I don't think she's going to face a significant amount of prison time, just considering that she doesn't have a record and it wasn't a violent crime, which I guess could also speak to how people view white collar crime versus blue collar crime. But that's a whole other topic.
Right. But betraying the public trust weighed against the fact that she was a public servant for over a decade. I imagine it's going to be a complicated calculus for the judge. It could be 4 or 5 years, I think. I don't think that's out of the realm. Did you make anything out of the sentencing date, which for Lady Trump is January 6, 2025?
People did note that after the sentencing date was announced, that it's on January 6th. But I mean, I think it was just the judge picking when her calendar was available, to be honest.
Yeah. Now, obviously, she loses her job as a justice of the peace in Pahrump, a judgeship she was allowed to hold, even though she doesn't have a law degree. She was recently elected by the folks out there for that position. But what else? I mean, if she is going to prison, et cetera, do you think that Michelle Fiore, what you know about her and the way she deals with adversity in her life, you think she's going to be able to fashion herself as an anti-government martyr?
That certainly would be her MO, especially considering her history with the Bundys and their anti-government stances. At the end of the day, I don't think this is the last we've heard of her by far. She already is talking about wanting to appeal. There was a part of the trial where she was trying to give a statement to the judge before she decided if she was going to take the stand or not. And the judge ultimately wouldn't let her do that. Mm. After that happened, reporters kept asking her, hey, what did you want to tell the judge? And she still hasn't told us that. She still hasn't said this is what my statement was going to be. So she obviously has a lot of thoughts on the case and she wants her opinion out there. But unfortunately, it's probably going to be on her terms just because she wasn't being candid with reporters during the trial. So yeah. We'll see when that happens.
Yeah. Well, if experience has told us anything with the force of nature that is Michelle Fiore, I think you're right, Caitlin. It won't be the last we hear about this case or her. Well, Caitlin Newberg of the Las Vegas Review-Journal, thanks for coming on CityCast Las Vegas.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
That's all for today here on CityCast Las Vegas. If you enjoyed the show, why not tell a friend? You could rate our show too, leave us a review, and subscribe to our morning newsletter. We'll be back tomorrow morning with more news from around the city. Till then, stay lucky.